Bibles, if you would, to Ecclesiastes chapter 1. I'll be there in a little bit. I want to talk today about without God or without Christ, you'll remain empty no matter what. No matter what, you'll remain empty if you don't have Christ in your life. I looked up in the dictionary and I was trying to find the definition of empty, what it would say. And it said something like having nothing, no one in it, so that your soul is just vacant. It's a life without real meaning, without satisfaction or completeness. You're just empty. Have you ever asked a question to yourself, why am I empty? Huh? Well, we know what the real answer is, don't we? We know that when you're born with a dead spirit. The spirit that relates to God. And because there's no relationship there, it creates a vacuum. It creates a hole. And that hole is empty because God's not in it. And we know that the natural man receiveth not the things of God. They're foolishness unto him. And so the first thing a person has to do is to come to faith in what God's word has to say to be able to receive Christ to fill that hole. To be able to be there inside of us. And we do that when we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He died for our sins, was buried, and rose again. When we put our faith in that gospel, that's the moment that God's Holy Spirit comes and takes up residence within inside our body, and that fills that vacuum. It fills that emptiness that we had in our life. Amen? Some questions. Have you ever wondered if life has any meaning? Have you ever attempted to cash in? You ever been tempted to do that? I'm just going to call it quits and end it all. Have you ever been torn up inside just to feel empty? Well, I'm glad to tell you this morning there's a solution, and it costs you nothing. It costs God, His only begotten Son, but it costs you nothing if you just will put your faith in Him. Now, almost everyone has experienced this emptiness, from the rich and famous to the unknown, the poor. It doesn't matter who you are. We all have experienced this emptiness that's inside of us. And emptiness is like a hole inside. We try to fill it with all kinds of things to make us happy. Actor Nicolas Cage said this, I wonder if there's a hole in the soul of my generation. Actor Harrison Ford said, you only want what you ain't got. And the interviewer said this to him, what ain't you got? Because he has a fortune. And he said, peace. Isn't that interesting? There was a hole, there was an emptiness there. Ted Turner, mogul, he commenting on this life, he said, it's like a B-minus grade movie. You don't want to leave in the middle, but you don't want to see it again. And that's with all his fortunes and his success, empty. We say, oh, if only I had more things. If only I had more money, like Aristotle Onassis had. But his daughter, Christina, said this, happiness is not based on money, and the greatest proof of that is my family. Isn't that interesting? Shortly after she made that statement, she died from a heart attack, from abusing diet pills, tranquilizers, and other drugs, and so on. People, they try anything and everything to try to fill that hole that's inside them. And especially drugs. We've had a lot of our icons go off the scenes because of that. If you remember Jerry Garcia of Grateful Dead, at the age of 53 years, a heroin overdose. He used to do drugs all the time, used to go into rehab all the time, till finally it took his life. And he was a multi-millionaire. And with all those things, it would have seemed like he would have been happy. Amen? but he wasn't. The Rolling Stone, Brian Jones, at the age of 25, drowned while he was on his drugs. Keith Moon, 31, of the drummer of Who, he died of an overdose. Sid Vicious, 21 years of age, of the Sex Pistols, he was dead of a heroin overdose. Elvis Presley, some of you have heard about him. The younger one said, who's he? But Elvis Presley, king of rock and roll at the age of 42, he had heart failure due to drugs. Other rock icons, Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, Jim Morrison of the Doors, comedians, John Belushi, Chris Farley of the Saturday Night Live fame, actor River Phoenix. Today there are many people who go through the Betty Ford Center. It's a revolving door for famous people. And that's not even mentioning our athletes that are too many to even mention at this time. But it seems like in people's hearts and lives, there's a hole. There's something that's missing there. Kurt Cobain of Nirvana, he always sang about confusion and frustration. At the age of 27, he took a shotgun and he killed himself. He had so much. He was famous, fortune. He had so much, yet he was so empty. He was so empty from using heroin long before his suicide. He said he wanted to name one of his albums, I Hate Myself and I Want to Die. What an emptiness. He left a suicide note. He said, I must be one of those narcissists who only appreciates things when they are alone. I'm too sensitive. I haven't felt the excitement far too many years now. And he took his life. His mother said this about his suicide. Now he is gone and has joined the stupid club. Isn't that amazing? Referring that now he's with Jimi Hendrix and Morrison and Joplin and all the others who have done that. On MTV, a young person commenting on Cobain's death said this, it seems to me that Kurt Cobain's recent suicide exemplified the emptiness that many in our generation feel right now. And we have a society that go around, they have a hole in their heart, and there's an emptiness there. It goes on, you can mention it, on and on. Recently, actor Philip Seymour, an overdose. I loved his acting. Rapper Chris Kelly, or Chris Cross, however you want to call him. Amy Winehouse. Whitney Houston. Perhaps her daughter, too. Heath Ledger. Now I even reached back. Dorothy of the Wizard of Oz, of all people. Judy Garland. Overdose of drugs. Somebody who was supposed to have the answers for mankind, Sigmund Freud. He even committed suicide because he couldn't handle life. And he was supposed to have the answers to life. But he was empty and had a hole himself. Fame icon Madonna. She said, I'm a tormented person. I have a lot of demons I'm wrestling with, but I want to be happy. She has all the money, all the things, but that doesn't fill that hole inside a person's heart. Evidently, fame, influence, or wealth does not guarantee one to be happy or to be full. Recently, a famous actor said this, I feel something's missing. Comedian Eddie Murphy in People's Magazine said, I don't think there's anyone who feels like there isn't something missing in their life. No matter how much money you make or how many cars or houses you have or how many people you make happy, life isn't perfect for anybody. That's Eddie Murphy. Another celebrity said it best, I thought. He said, I found that I couldn't fill that empty spot. I couldn't shove enough drugs, women, cars, stereos, houses, stardom in that hole to make me feel good. I guess that's why a lot of people overdose. They get to the point that where their hole becomes so big that they just die. It states in Mark chapter 8, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake, to live for Christ, and the gospels, the same shall save it. For," now get this, "what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" He might have all the wealth, all the toys that life can offer, but if he gains all that and lose his soul, which would be his soul, but also his life in a sense. Cher, she had fame, fortune, fun. She said this, she believes in reincarnation. She said, "Maybe next time I'll be a cowboy. Maybe next time I'll do better." And you can sense the emptiness in her statement. Comedian Jim Carrey, he's had a lot of success. His films have grossed millions. He's famous for Pet Detective. It's one of my favorite shows. Bruce Almighty. I love that too. Little butt-dwelling monkey. You remember that eye anyway? He's famous for Liar, Liar. Huh? He gets $20 million per film, by the way. He was interviewed. The interviewer said, "Some say comedians are really clowns crying on the inside." Carrey said, "It's true. In some of his past bouts with depression and self-loathing." All this, he said, "you have to go through your periods where you cry, you sob, and you scream. I've gone on little personal vacations all by myself, and I sit and curse at the TV for a whole weekend." How sad, how empty. Jonathan David of rock band Korn on MTV said this. He was holding up and kissing a bottle of Prozac. And he said, "This is my best friend. I don't know true happiness. I'm not a happy person. I play like it. I act a lot like it. But inside, actually, I'm not really happy." He was empty. You see, emptiness touches all types of people. Renowned J. Robert Oppenheimer, he was the director of the Alamos, New Mexico research team on the Manhattan Project that produced the first atomic bomb. He was asked about his achievements just before he died, and he said, "I'm a complete failure. All those achievements that I've done, they leave on the tongue only the taste of ashes." He was dying empty. All of us live for something. We have a passion that drives us. Otherwise, we're not living, we're just existing. Most hope that at the end of their life, they'll be more than just being a statistic or a few lines in the obituary column. Let me ask you this question. What is your main desire right now? What do you truly live for? What's consistently on your mind? What do you dream about? What moves you? And whatever it is, that will control and influence the direction of your life. Most people, they think about the desire of having other things. They desire of accumulating wealth, things, property. But few people will admit that. There's an old saying that says, "He who dies with the most toys wins." To them, life is just a high-stakes game. But getting things is never enough. The drive to accumulate takes away the ability to enjoy what one has already accumulated. Amen? Example, you get a new car. Boy, you got that new car. It's exciting. It's great. And then some of your friends get a newer one. And their car has more power, more gadgets. And then suddenly, your car doesn't make you happy anymore. Now, Bob Richardson, you listen to this message here, wherever you may be. There you are. I'm kidding him. Yeah. Or you start looking at another's mate and you think, I wish I was married to them. I like to trade in my mate for that one. And you start thinking like that. But being materialistic or lustful is not only for the affluent. Most people, they live for pleasure, for passion, for parties. Ecclesiastes 1:9 says this here. The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. Do you know something? Throughout history, nothing's new. Today is no different. The same lies, the same pursuits. The wealthiest man in the Bible that we know is Solomon. And one day he looked up on and thought upon all that he had. And he came to this conclusion, Ecclesiastes 2:9-11. So I was great and increased more than all that were before me in Jerusalem. Also my wisdom remained with me. And whatsoever mine eyes desired, whatever I wanted, I kept not from them. I withheld not my heart from any joy, for my heart rejoiced in all my labor, and this was my portion of all my labor. Then I looked on all the works that my hands had wrought, and on the labor that I had labored to do, and behold, all was vanity and vexation of spirit, and there was no profit under the sun. He says in chapter 5, verse 10, he that loveth silver shall not be satisfied with silver, nor he that loveth abundance with increases. This is also vanity. Solomon said, listen, whatever I wanted, I could have it. And as I looked back and I had all those things, all of it's vanity. It's empty. It doesn't mean anything. Solomon had all the wealth, all the women, all the wine, all the songs, all the luxury. But did it make him happy? Did it make him peaceful or full? And the answer is no. Even with all of that, he was still unhappy and he was still empty. Yet today there are so many people, they're looking for these ways, these things, for their happiness, their fulfillment. Eric Hoffer said something very wise. Now I'm coming down the stretch here. He said this, the search for happiness is one of the chief sources of unhappiness. And that, I thought that was good. Amen? I told you before about, but a lot of haven't heard, a distraught, empty, unhappy man went to a counselor for help, evaluating this man's miserable condition. The counselor said this, forget all about these things. Go and see the comedian who is performing at the local comedy club. I hear he's keeping all the people in stitches. Go listen to him and you'll forget all your troubles. There was a long moment of silence. And then the client groaned and said, I am that comedian. Huh? Made everybody else laugh, but inside his own life, he was empty. And truly, the world's happiness is different from God's version of happiness. The world's happiness is dependent upon things, things going well. If you've made a score some way, you're in good health, the bills are paid, you feel fine. And perhaps you're happy today, but then if something goes wrong, you get sick. Somebody cuts you off of the road as you're going down the street. Your marriage breaks up. You have a financial reversal. Someone's hurt you. You then don't feel so happy. All of a sudden, you're empty. That's what the world offers you. It might give you a temporary high. But when you come down, you're empty. And it gets worse, and it gets worse, and it gets worse. That's why God says we need to stop seeking these things as our priority. And we need to step up and say, I want to seek God. I want God. I want His way, His purpose for my life. And when I get saved and I begin to live for God and have a relationship with Him, then true fullness and happiness happens, because that empty hole that I once had inside of my heart finally is filled. Finally, it's complete. Amen. The opposite of emptiness is being full. Ephesians 3:19 says this, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen. God is satisfying. God won't let you down. God will fill that hole and turn your life around. He says this in Romans 15:29. And I am sure that when I come unto you, I shall come in the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ. It is the gospel that fills that hole, that emptiness. You say, what's the gospel? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preach unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received. Now here's the gospel. How that Christ died for our sins. That means we're sinners. We can't save ourselves. But Christ loved us enough, He died for our sins on an old rugged cross. And that, and He died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Amen? That, and by the way, and that alone is the gospel. The gospel is not doing good. It's not joining a church. It's not giving your money. It's not keeping the law. The gospel is the fact that you're a sinner on your way to hell and you have no hope. Not only will you go to hell, you have a hole in your life until you go to hell. But Jesus Christ said, I love you so much, I died for your sins, and I was buried, and I rose again for your justification. All you need to do is believe in me, and I'll save you. Amen? Now, how can I do that? Romans 3:22. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. God says the only thing necessary for a man, and it's not a work, is for us to have faith in what His message just said. That gospel. He states in chapter 4, verse 25. Who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. The reason He did that, chapter 5, verse 8. But God commendeth His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Even when we didn't deserve it, He loved us. Amen? See, God's not mad at you. God loves you. And He wants to save you. And He wants to fill that empty hole that you have in your heart because you don't have Him. And He did, He provided this salvation plan just for you to fill that hole, to fill that emptiness, and He did it out of love for you. He states this in chapter 5, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, being justified, how? By faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access, how? By faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. In other words, I understand I'm a sinner. I understand there's nothing I can do of myself, for by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You see, it's all about God, and He's the only one who gets the glory for saving you then. Amen? He states this, Titus 1:2, in hope of eternal life, which God, that what? Cannot lie, promised. God says, if you will believe in his gospel, he'll save you. And the good news is, not me, not Grace Point, no church, but God promises that he'll save you if you'll believe in him. Amen? And then when you put your faith in that gospel, the death, burial, resurrection of Christ for yourself, when you do that, Colossians 1:19 says this, for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. You see, the wonderful thing, in Christ, there's complete fullness. You see, you're in Adam as a sinner. When you put your faith in the gospel, he takes you out of your position of being in Adam, and he places you into Christ. And being in Christ makes you full now, makes you complete now. He states in Colossians 2:9, for in him, Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete, you're full. You no longer are empty. You no longer have a hole in your heart. Amen? Now you're full. How? With him. Amen? What a blessing. I read my Bible. Jesus was a friend of sinners. He loved just the common people. They called him a guy who hung around with wine bibbers. In other words, he was around where the average Joe was, and he tried to be the light to them. He was a friend of sinners. Jesus was a finder of sinners. He's been looking for you. Huh? He found that woman at the well, didn't he? And then Jesus is a forgiver of sinners. Anybody who ever came to him and believed in him, he said, go and sin no more. Your sins are forgiven. So that's what Jesus Christ does. But if you remain without Christ, you remain lost, without hope, and you will be empty. And all the things of this world, you cannot cram enough into that hole to satisfy you and make you complete. Amen? I know what I'm talking about this morning. I've been there, done that. We grew up, interesting family, 10 kids. I'm the baby, the nice-looking young one. Oh, my two sisters are here today. I forgot, they're a little older than me. Took his way to a foster home. Welfare did for a while, till mom got every one of us back finally after a few years. Never had a dad that was there. Took off the night I was born. I know what you're thinking. But I never had a male figure there. And I think as I look back all my life, I was trying to be identified as being something. Trying to cram whatever I could in that hole, that emptiness. And of course, throughout my life, I crammed the wrong things. Whatever you could think of, I put in that emptiness. And I always came up empty. I might have had a little high at the moment. And I did get high a few times. But let me say something to you. It got worse and it got worse. Until one day I heard about Jesus Christ at the age of 24. God moved on my heart, my spirit, and I got saved that day. And ever since that time, I've had a friend who has stuck closer than even a brother, my Lord Jesus Christ. Huh? Anytime you need him, he's there to help you, to walk with you, to love you, to support you. Why would we turn our back on that kind of a person? They were singing the song, I Stand. It is amazing, isn't it? It's amazing that he would love people like you and like me. But yet he does. Will you trust him this morning? Let's bow our head and close our eyes. You're here today, and if you were to die, you don't know where you would spend eternity, or you do know, and it wouldn't be with Christ. You today, you have an emptiness in your life, in your heart. Christ says, I'm the solution. I'm your answer. I died for your sin. They buried me, and 3 days later, I arose victoriously to conquer even death, to guarantee you eternal life, if only you would believe in me and my work. And you would say, the Spirit of God has touched my heart this morning. I want that emptiness filled too. I want to know my sins are forgiven. I am a true child of God. I'm going to say a simple prayer. Saying the prayer doesn't save you unless you believe it in your heart. You believe it in your heart, and you should, because of what God's word says, not because of what I said. Just say this prayer right where you are, right in your heart, in this moment. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. I do believe that Jesus Christ is your Son. He died for my sins and rose again. The best way I know how, I'm asking you, God, please save me, because I believe the gospel. In Jesus' name. Now, with your heads bowed, you would say, Pastor Jim, as a word of testimony, we don't come out, we don't embarrass you, we don't force you to come forward, we don't do that here. But you would say, as a word of testimony, I want you to know that God touched my heart today, and today I believed in that gospel. And I just prayed and asked God to save me. You would say, I just did that. I want you to just lift your hand up right now as a word of testimony, right where you're seated. Anybody like that this morning? Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I counted 4 or 5. We thank God for that. Father, thank you for making it so easy for us to be able to be saved. Just believe in the gospel. And the person that hung on that cross that makes the gospel possible. God, I pray you be with these people. I pray now they get in your word. I pray that they begin to start running around with good Christians that will help them begin to grow in their faith now. They're starting a new journey. We know the devil hates that, and he will fight that. But God, you're greater than the devil. And if they just go your way, they will have victory in their life. So I pray you be with them in a special way. Be with our people. Give us a greater burden for those who don't know Christ. Help us to become unsatisfied with just going status quo, same old, same old. God, begin to break our hearts that we might see that there are a lot of wonderful people out there, but they're lost. We have the answer in Jesus Christ. May we never be ashamed of that. In Jesus' name. And everybody said?
We hope that you received a blessing from today's broadcast. We would love to have you to visit us in person Sunday at 10 a.m. in New Whiteland. You can watch us live and view past services on our website at gpindy.net. For more information, please visit our website or contact us by phone. Until next week, may God richly bless you is our prayer.